Welcome to St. Christopher's Episcopal Church. We are so glad that you are here to worship with us today. Just a reminder that the children will be following Lissa and the cross. Well, Avery will be carrying the cross to go to Children's Chapel today, and then they will be coming back in at the Peace. Is that right? Okay. And that's going to be so that our children can start with us and then rejoin us in the service. And that way we can make sure we're able to get everyone and lead them over to where the children's formation is. Proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God and worship him upon his holy hill, for the Lord our God is the Holy One. God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be thy kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Thank you.
and also with you.
Let us pray. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth. When he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble, to whom then will you compare me? Or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see who created these. He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel? My way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 47, verses 1 through 12 and 21c. We'll read it together in unison. Hallelujah.
How good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant it is to honor him with praise. The Lord rebuilds Jerusalem. He gathers the exiles of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He counts the number of the stars and calls them all by their names. Great is our Lord, mighty in power. There is no limit to his wisdom. The Lord lifts up the lowly, but casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make music to our God upon the harp. He covers the heavens with clouds and prepares rain for the earth. He makes grass to grow upon the mountains and green plants to serve mankind. He provides food for flocks and herds and for the young ravens when they cry. He is not impressed by the might of a horse. He has no pleasure in the strength of a man. But the Lord has pleasure in those who fear him, and in those who await his gracious favor. Hallelujah.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation, I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews, I became as a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might by all means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring town so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went through Galilee proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus and the disciples were in the synagogue, and Jesus was amazing everyone present with his teaching and liberated a man from an unclean spirit. Now, a lot of us may be tempted to linger and bask in the accolades and all the praise and the applause, but Jesus doesn't stick around for any of that. And we'll soon see how full this day turned out to be for him. So immediately they left the synagogue. Jesus is always on the move in the Gospel of Mark, And they left the big public space of the synagogue and went to a more private place, Simon Peter's home. And as soon as he enters the house, he's immediately told about Simon's mother-in-law, who is ill and in bed with a fever. We don't know why she had a fever, but we do know that for many living under imperial rule, they often did not have safe water and easy access to food, and were no strangers to sickness and shortened lifespans. Unfortunately, much of the world still lives like this today. So it stands to reason that the household was very concerned about Simon Peter's mother-in-law. Jesus doesn't really ask any questions. He just came in and took her by the hand. There was no asking her if she needed to confess her sins. He did not ask her about her faith. In fact, in no way did he question her worthiness. She was in need, and he responded. No strings attached. In her world, she was a woman, which meant she had no agency of her own, seemingly had no husband or son to look after her, which would have been the custom, and we don't even know her name. You have to have some importance to be mentioned at all, let alone by name. So she is only known to us as Simon's mother-in-law, who society at the time perceived as irrelevant. Jesus did not. He took her by the hand. Like many healing stories in the Gospels, it is Jesus' touch that heals. But Jesus doesn't just touch her hand. He takes it and lifts her up. What is amazing here is that this same verb that they use for lift her up, for raising her up, he takes her by the hand and raises her up, that was used for the raising of Jairus' daughter from the dead. And even twice later in this gospel, it is the same verb for Jesus' own resurrection, his raising up. There's a powerful message being sent by Mark here. Jesus takes this woman by the hand and raises her up. It's no accident that there is a connection between this woman being raised up, foreshadowing Jesus being raised up. Mark is linking these two servants together. She is healed and restored, and immediately she begins to serve. She is Jesus' first deacon. There is no woman who is bowing. This is no woman who's bowing to cultural convention. We're being given insight into how Jesus intends to lead as a servant. To serve in the raising up of the lowly, the restoration of those who suffer, even the resurrection of the dead. Jesus did not ask anything of her, from her. But she began to serve out of her own gratitude and by her own choice, and is already following in the steps of the one who just healed her. The one who came to lead us on the path of eternity turns our understanding of leadership upside down. And instead of giving orders and directing others to do the work and what they should be doing, Jesus leads as the one that is a servant himself, by example. I came to serve, not to be served, he'll later tell his disciples. Simon Peter's mother-in-law already understands this. She demonstrates this for the disciples and for you and me now. Simon Peter may later on come to be that lead disciple, but his mother-in-law was ahead of him in understanding what was going on. And then, when the sun had set, like good law-abiding Judaists of Capernaum, who waited until the sun had set and the Sabbath was over, they all showed up at Simon's house. The whole city gathered at their door. Now, I don't know if that's hyperbole from Mark, but nevertheless, it must have been a humdinger of a crowd. Don't forget that this is still the same Sabbath day we heard about last week, where Jesus had started out the synagogue teaching, exorcised a man from an unclean spirit, went to Simon's house, healed his mother-in-law, and now the whole town shows up for healing. Remember how astonished they were at Jesus in the synagogue? That word spread fast. And by evening, everyone who was sick from all kinds of things, and those who were in need of being freed from the evil that controlled them, they were all there looking for healing or liberation from evil. I'm just going to say that Sundays are exhausting for those of us who serve the church. So reading about this Sabbath day in the life of Jesus made me feel wiped out. We're still in the first chapter of Mark. The setting of the stage for what was to be Jesus' ministry and purpose. As exhausting as that day had to have been, Jesus goes out in the wee hours of the morning before the sun rises and a new day begins and prays. He doesn't do it all. He doesn't keep working. At some point, he stops. Even though the entire town has shown up, he stops and goes out by himself to pray. This is the part we really need to pay attention to. We're really good at the do-do-do. Make a song about that if you want. But not so good at the stopping, pulling away to replenish ourselves, and most importantly, to pray. The work is not more important than the rest, and the rest is not more important than the prayer. Ministry and service are whole, healthy, and complete when it contains all three of these elements. If one is neglected, things get out of balance and become unhealthy. We live in a society that is addicted to productivity. We measure it, we analyze it, and we base our worth on it. God does not. You are worthy because you are. If your soul and body are not tended to, you cannot effectively attend to anyone else. Now, clearly Jesus knew his need to be alone and to pray, to restore himself and to refuel from a day in the synagogue and a day at a friend's home where the whole town ended up. He also seemed to know he had to just sneak out of the house because no one knew where he was. I sure hope Simon's mother-in-law got away and to pray and give thanks too. Introverts know this wisdom, but I think even extroverts who love being with people know they need time to be still, to be quiet, to listen to God in the silence. Those that don't pay a price. And there is time to do the work, and there is a time to be still and listen. If you're not listening to God and being still, God will not be leading you. You will. Let me tell you from experience that that does not work out well. And when Jesus snuck out the kitchen door, he knew he was tapped. He stopped for a bit. Maybe too the needs, all the suffering of the people overwhelmed him like it does us. So he had to pray. As we seek to serve Christ here at St. Christopher's, we are quite involved in tending to the needs of our community and each other. We understand this call, this mandate from Jesus. What we must equally understand is our need to replenish daily. If we don't, we won't last long in our service. Prayer is like Jesus taking you by the hand and raising you up. That precedes doing the work of serving. If we do not balance our days and weeks of service with prayer and being still before God, our ministry will not flourish. We all know you can't drive a car without fuel. Neither can you serve without prayer. Like our dear unnamed sister in the gospel reading, let Jesus take your hand and lift you up. Take yourself away from the fray and be still and pray. Let God raise you up and let God restore you. Amen.
In sure and certain hope of the resurrection, let us proclaim our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe
in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In peace, we pray to you, Lord God,
for all people in their daily life and work,
for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone,
for this community, the nation, and the world,
for all who work for justice, freedom, and peace,
for the just and proper use of your creation,
for the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression,
for all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble,
for those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy,
for the peace and unity of the Church of God,
for all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth,
for Michael, our presiding bishop, and Andy, Kay, Jeff, and Hector, our bishops, and for all bishops and other ministers,
for all who serve God in the church,
for the special needs and concerns of this congregation, especially Atia, Mike, Sally, Elizabeth, Ben, Joyce, Jeanette, Nancy, Hayes, Sally, the Graves family, Mary Ann, Bishop Curry, Jim, Marsha, Robin, Bud, Emily, Catherine, Kenyon, Daniel, Kale. Are there others? Hear us, Lord,
for your mercy is great.
Thank you, Lord, for the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King.
and praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom, especially Tom, Linda, Todd, Cynthia. Are there others? Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them
who put their trust in you.
Let us pray. Grant, O God,
that your holy and life-giving Spirit may so move every human heart that barriers which divide us may crumble, suspicions disappear, and hatred cease, that our divisions being healed, all people may live in justice and peace.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we can humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Getting really, really, really close to Lent, so if you want to get all your alleluias out, you need to come up next Sunday. Let's see, what do we have here? The next meet and greet session is February 19th at the Stevens House, and I believe we are full. So we have two more coming up, and one is going to be family friendly at Jane Samuels, so call the office, call Jane. We need to copy both places, okay? So we're keeping the same list. If we have too many people, we'll be there all night for what I'm trying to accomplish. So we really want to keep these small groups. And then Marty has graciously offered to have an afternoon session for those that don't really want to be driving at night and staying up late. So that date will also be coming out in the connections. 23rd is the one for Jane Samuels, the family one. Childcare will be provided, and so bring your whole family. The Lenten series, A Way of Love, will start on the 21st, the Wednesday after Ash Wednesday, and that will be from 6 to 7:30 in the parish hall, and we'll be having a potluck. So, you know, if you really like to cook and shine, we really like to eat it. Lissa is also still looking for volunteers because we will have a simultaneous children's Lenten program at the same time. So again, families are all welcome to come, and we'll be providing programs for tall people and short people. The bishop is coming March 24th. We really have a very busy time, don't we? Because the bishop is also coming February 15th for my installation service here, which is the day after Ash Wednesday. So I'm telling you, you just heard my sermon. Get your rest now. Keep praying. We got a big week coming up, and I'd love to have you all here at the installation service. There'll be a reception afterwards, and it will be a great time of celebration right after we start Lent. But, you know, that happens. The second time Bishop Ryan will be here will be Palm Sunday, March 24th, and that we will be having confirmations and receptions at that time. So we've got enough people. We are going to start a class February 25th. That will give us 4 Sundays to learn all you need to know about the Christian faith in the Episcopal Church. We'll do our best. But we will be having confirmation class, and since we're only having 4 sessions, you really need to attend them all if you've not been confirmed in the church before. And that will be, we will have something for youth and adults. Let's see, am I forgetting something? I think, yes, Kathy has a...
I have 2 opportunities for volunteer service that I'd like to bring to your attention. And these handouts are in the narthex if you'd like to take it with you. These are both for Foundation Communities, which is, we have 2 right up the street. One is for their after-school program, and the other is for their healthy food pantry. We already have a couple of people that are volunteering in both of these venues. So if you'd like to make this your living discipline,
we got it. And reaching out to our local community like that will invite people into the church. They need to know we're here, they need to know we care, and they need to know that we're welcome. So when you volunteer for something like that, you're not just fulfilling, you know, your service to God's people, but also you're letting us be known out in the community, and that's really important. Yes, Larry.
In addition to all that other activities, 13, we're having our pancake supper.
Yes.
Starting at 6:30.
And that's going to be good.
It always is. I fired a South Sausage Cook from last year.
There's a story there.
We were prepared to do pre-cooked sausage, but we didn't have pre-cooked sausage. Warming it in the oven didn't work right.
Oh.
And he was just awesome.
Right, and we'll make sure that gets in the connections. And then following Shrove Tuesday is Ash Wednesday service, so you see the theme here. 3 services in a row that week. Are there any birthdays or anniversaries? Birthday, well, we can bless have you because you became one and it will work.
Oh,
okay. Birthday and anniversary. Birthday. That's why he's wearing a jacket today. And birthday. Okay. Let us pray. Oh God, our times are in your hands. Look with favor, we pray, on your servants as they begin another year. Grant that they may grow in wisdom and grace. Strengthen them in their goodness all the days of their life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Thank you, and then for anniversary. O God, you have consecrated the covenant of marriage that has represented the spiritual unity between Christ and Christ's church. Send forth your blessing upon these, your servants, that they may so love, honor, and cherish each other in faithfulness and patience, in wisdom and true godliness, that their home may be a haven of blessing and peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Thank you all very much. Blessings on the birthday of my dear. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself as a sacrifice.
Save to the Lord.
be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of your glory to the face of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace, and on the last day bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
That Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
us pray.
Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food and the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Do not be dismayed by the brokenness of the world. All things break, and all things can be mended. Not with time, as they say, but with intention. So go, love intentionally, extravagantly, unconditionally. The broken world waits in darkness for the light that is you. Bless you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia.